morning, everyone, and welcome to Ohio EPA's 2022 Virtual Compliance Assistance Conference. My name is Helen Miller, and I'm with the Division of Environmental and Financial Assistance here at Ohio EPA, and will be moderating the Backflow in Your Public Water System session. Ohio EPA's 2022 Virtual Compliance Assistance Conference has 24 sessions over 2 weeks. Today, our sessions focus on drinking and groundwaters. Registration information and a conference agenda are located on Ohio EPA's conference webpage. We hope you're able to join us for an additional conference sessions. Note there's only one more session after this one this afternoon. Please remember it's never too late to sign up for the next conference session, and all sessions are being recorded for you to view later. Before we get started, we'd like to point your attention to one of today's environmental fun facts. Do you know how many public water systems there are in Ohio? About 90% of Ohio's population receives water from 4,323 active public water systems. It takes more than 12,000 certified operators to run these systems. You can scan the QR code on this slide to learn more about the public water systems and how they're regulated by Ohio EPA. Next, I'd like to introduce our presenter, Maria Lucente, in our Division of Drinking and Groundwaters. Maria is the engineering manager in Ohio EPA's Division of Drinking and Groundwater Central Office. Maria holds a bachelor's degree from Youngstown State University and a master's degree from The Ohio State University, both in civil and environmental engineering. She has over 20 years of experience with Ohio EPA, including plan review of drinking water treatment plants and distribution projects, technical assistance on design and regulatory design standards for drinking water treatment, and as the division's lead on backflow prevention and cross-connection control requirements for public water systems. Maria is also an Ohio licensed professional engineer. We also have Megan Shortridge with our Southwest District Office from Drinking and Groundwaters answering questions behind the scenes today. And now I'm turning over the microphone to Maria.
Hey, thank you. Good morning. Thank you for joining me for my presentation on backflow in your public water system. Well, backflow is what we are trying to avoid, and this presentation will provide an overview of how we can achieve this objective through a backflow prevention and cross-connection control program. In my presentation, I will provide an overview of backflow prevention and cross-connection control concepts. I'll highlight some of the components of a good backflow prevention program. I'll go through some of the rule improvements that we've recently implemented and some common issues that we typically find regarding backflow prevention. So before I continue, I'd like to take a quick poll. So please bring your attention to the poll question. The question is, do you know about backflow prevention and cross-connection control? Yes, no, or you're not sure? Please go ahead and select one of your answers.
And I'm launching the poll, so you can go ahead and make your selection. And as a reminder, I know some people log on when we're still going through the introductory remarks. You'll also find handouts, and one of the handouts for this session is a PDF copy of the PowerPoint slides, if you'd like to download a copy and keep a copy for yourself. And it looks like most people have voted. If you have not, go ahead and please make your final selection. And I will be closing the poll shortly. and I'm sharing the results. Back to you, Maria.
Okay, thank you. All right, it looks like most of you have some familiarity with backflow prevention. That's good to know. So some of this will be an overview for you, and we'll provide you some updates on the rule revisions. Great, let's move on. So education is a big part of addressing the problem, and understanding some basic terms is important. So let's start with cross-connection. Now, cross-connection is any arrangement by which backflow can occur. For example, you can have a connection between two piping systems. For backflow, it's essentially the flow of water or other liquids, mixtures, or substances into the distributing pipes of a public water supply from any source other than the intended source. So there are actually two types of backflow. There's back siphonage and back pressure. Now, back siphonage is caused by a negative gauge pressure condition that exists in the water supply piping. It's essentially a situation where it's less than atmospheric, a partial or full vacuum pressure condition. And this can lead to contaminants being sucked into the source, such as if you take a sip or drink through a straw. It's that same siphoning action. Now, back pressure is when a contaminant source has a greater pressure than the public water system's pressure and overcomes the public water system's pressure, allowing contaminants to flow back into the system. Now, this is an example of a back siphonage condition that actually happened. There was a cross connection created to a fire hydrant to this herbicide holding tank. The water supply from the town, the pressure dropped. Then the herbicide was siphoned into the water supply. This shutoff off here was obviously open, and the water and the contaminants from the herbicide holding tank backflowed into the public water supply. And there was actually herbicide in the village's water supply. So a shutoff valve is not sufficient backflow prevention. What is required is an installation of a backflow preventer at the point of connection to the fire hydrant to prevent this from happening. Now, this is an example of a back pressure condition. Here you have a cross connection. You have the city main that's supplying water to this building, but you also have a private well on the property that's supplying water to the premises. And they're using this private well for lawn irrigation. And there is a cross connection, and there's just a shutoff valve separating the two. Now, a back pressure condition can result if the city main's pressure drops, the private well is operating, the pump overcomes the pressure in the building, and backflows the private well supply into the plumbing of the building, as well as back into the public water supply. If this valve is open or fails, this can happen. So what we need is to ensure there is no cross connection here. There must be a physical separation and a backflow preventer installed at the service connection to prevent any backflow into the public water supply. So overall, we need a comprehensive response in order to ensure backflow prevention and cross connection control. We need to address backflow hazards that are associated with water use practices from cross connections to contamination within plumbing systems and to the public water supply. This is necessary to maintain the quality of the public potable water supply from source to tap. Now, this responsibility is shared. It's shared among the regulatory agencies, such as Ohio EPA and the plumbing authorities, the supplier of water, if you're a municipal public water system or a single property public water system owner, and also the consumer is responsible for not creating cross connections that can lead to backflow. For Ohio EPA and the public water system, we generally deal with the containment principle. This is the act of installing a backflow preventer, an air gap, or a testable assembly to protect contaminants from backflowing into a public water distribution system. For single property community public water systems and non-community public water systems, backflow preventers are installed at the cross connection. For all other community public water systems, backflow preventers are installed at the service connection to the consumer's water system, unless there's other areas in the rule where it's specified differently. In order to kind of illustrate where the jurisdictional authorities lie, I've provided some schematics here. This would be typical of a public water system that is selling to a customer through a metered service connection. As a public water system, your authority lies from your water main all the way through to the containment backflow preventer. And then after that, the Department of Commerce and their plumbing jurisdiction takes over, and they would require what we call isolation backflow preventers within the plumbing, the internal plumbing. And the overarching responsibility is on the consumer, obviously, to not create cross connections in the first place. Now, this is another diagram that I wanted to present to illustrate how backflow prevention applies to single property community water systems or non-community water systems, such as for a building that is a public water system. So the building owner has their own public water supply. This example actually shows a school. So we have the well, a pressure tank, water softener. So this is considered the water treatment plant. And then the entry point is where it enters into the plumbing that supplies all the service connections and all the end uses, like a boiler, an irrigation system, and so forth. So in this application, the public water system owner obviously has jurisdiction over the entire system, but Ohio EPA has jurisdiction over the treatment plant, but it also has jurisdiction over backflow prevention requirements because it's a public water system. I wanted to emphasize, however, that the building owner still needs to comply with the plumbing code and get the necessary permits for the plumbing. So the different backflow preventers that we use to try to mitigate cross connections and hazards that they present vary. The first one, the air gap, is essentially a physical separation, which prevents backflow from occurring. There's an air gap, and there's a bulk water loading station air gap device you may be familiar with. Now, assemblies, there are several different types of assemblies. These are testable. They have shutoff valves. These are the reduced pressure principle backflow prevention assemblies and the detector check assembly version, double check assemblies and the double check detector check assembly. And typically the air gap and assemblies are what we think of that are acceptable to use as containment and the ones that are referenced in our rules. Now, devices typically go with the plumbing code and on specific water use practices or plumbing installations, such as a dual check, the hose bib vacuum breaker, atmospheric vacuum breaker, or pressure vacuum breaker. Then there's also specific valving and piping configurations that can be used. An interchangeable connection, such as a four-way valve or swing connector, that's when there has to be dual water supplies made available. It allows alternate use, but not simultaneous use. And then the barometric loop, which uses a concept that water will only rise 34 feet. Essentially, the pipe rises to break the vacuum and to prevent a back siphonage condition. These are just some pictures of applications of backflow preventers. On the top left, you have an air gap into a chemical mixing tank. To the right of that is a water loading station with an air gap device here to protect the public water supply as well as the users from contamination. And on the right-hand side, at the top is a reduced pressure principle backflow preventer that's actually installed within a heated enclosure because it's outside. This particular one is a hot box. And then below that is the reduced pressure detector assembly version of it. Typically, you'll see these on fire protection systems. It consists of a standard size RP with a bypass line that has a meter and a smaller sized RP on it. And this is to detect any unauthorized use or leaks in the fire protection system. So on the left-hand side here on the top is a double check valve assembly. And below that is the detector check assembly version. As you'll notice, as I mentioned, these have the shutoff valves on either end and these test cocks, which make these assemblies testable. And then on the right-hand side on the top, you have a picture of a pressure vacuum breaker, which is typically seen on sprinkler systems or irrigation systems. And below here is a hose bib applied vacuum breaker on a Y connection, we typically see on threaded connections. And this is just another illustration of anti-siphon devices. This is a hose connection vacuum breaker, an ASSE 1011, very common on your hose bibs. And then the 1052 is another type of vacuum breaker for a hose connection. Okay, let's stop here and take another quick poll. So please turn your attention to your screen and I will read the question. Are you familiar with the components of an adequate backflow prevention program? Yes, no, or you're not sure? Please select an answer.
And I have launched the poll, so go ahead and make your selection. It looks like a lot of people have made their selection. If you have not, please begin to make your final selection. And I will be closing the poll shortly. Okay, and I am sharing the results. Back to you, Maria.
Okay, thank you. All right, well, it looks we have a mixed response here, but most of you are familiar with the components of an adequate backflow prevention program. So what we'll go over next are basically the main components of what Ohio EPA would consider an adequate backflow prevention program. This is a checklist of the minimum requirements. First off, we'd like to see that the public water system has a local ordinance or other legal mechanisms in place to control cross connections. This is something that can be written in, as mentioned, into a local ordinance or rules for the facility. We also want to see a written program which outlines the requirements for initial inspection and resurveys, installation, testing, and inspection of backflow preventers, that there's record keeping, there's residential education, and the opportunity to report backflow incidences. Now, it's also important that backflow preventers are inspected periodically for wear and tear and if they're leaking. And they also must be tested every 12 months by a qualified individual. You also want to know that your requiring backflow preventers that are appropriate for the degrees of hazard present. By rule, we also want you to require that if a customer is not maintaining their backflow preventers or any other requirements from the rules, that you discontinue service to that customer. Or if it's an end use or a tap, that you remove that tap from service until the backflow preventer is repaired and replaced. We want to see that you have a record of where booster pumps are installed and that they have the minimum pressure sustaining controls on them and that they're tested every year as well. You should ensure that there are no cross connections with an auxiliary water system. Auxiliary water systems must have a physical separation and not be connected to the public water supply piping. And if you are a public water system that sells to a customer through a metered service connection, you would also want to require a reduced pressure principle backflow preventer at the service connection. You want to ensure that backflow prevention needs for all water connections have been identified and addressed. You need to do this through initial inspections and also through periodic surveys and investigations so that you can determine the current water use practices and that adequate protection is in place. So you need to have a mechanism in place to identify needs on new connections as well as do these surveys on existing connections periodically. We also don't want you to forget about backflow preventers that are located within your treatment plants and other facilities that are owned by the public water system or the municipality to ensure that these are tested every 12 months as well. We want air gaps provided at bulk water sales stations to ensure that cross connections do not occur. We highly encourage public water system staff to receive training on cross-connection control and backflow prevention concepts and applications. The public water system owner or operator of record must be able to provide oversight and be able to attest to the status of the backflow prevention program. So as a public water system owner, you should not remove yourself from, you know, what is going on with your backflow prevention program. You should be familiar with what is happening and how it's being implemented so that you could speak to your inspector when they ask you about it. So next, I'd like to move into the improvements that we've made to Ohio EPA's backflow prevention rules. These rules will become final as of October 10th, 2022, and you should be able to find the updated versions on the website at that time. So essentially, these changes were made to provide additional clarification. They weren't really made to provide any new requirements, but in response to a lot of questions that we received about what are the requirements and how do they apply to me, and also internally to provide some consistency on how we enforce the backflow prevention rules and requirements. Let's start with 9501. 9501 is where we find the definitions that apply to this chapter. They would be all the terms that we use in this chapter that are not otherwise defined in chapter 374581, which is where our primary drinking water rules are. We added the definition of single property community water system, which means a community water system that is located on a single property or contiguous properties under the ownership or control of a single person. Now, this was done to help us define what the expectations are for these types of public water systems, these smaller public water systems that may consist of only a building. And then we also provided a definition of containment principle backflow preventer. That was actually already in the rule. We just kind of modified it a little more. And then we added a definition of isolation backflow prevention device. to assist with understanding the provisions in 9506. We did this to define the jurisdiction of Ohio EPA and public water systems versus, you know, plumbing code jurisdiction. We also included a comprehensive list of standards that are referenced in the chapter and the applicable additions in use. It's basically all in one place now in 9501 for your reference. 9502, there was just minor improvements. 9502 essentially is a prohibition on cross connections and the requirement that public water systems must have a backflow prevention program consistent with these rules. Again, this applies to all public water systems, large or small, even if it's a building public water system. And that is what we aim to do in these improvements, is to clarify expectations for the different types of public water systems. 9503 was one that had some major revisions to it to provide this clarification. We clarified expectations for the supplier of water when conducting initial assessments and when conducting the periodic investigations and surveys. We also indicate when an on-site inspection is necessary versus instead utilizing the survey questionnaires or residential educational campaigns. So for the surveys and investigations, a public water system is required to first conduct an initial assessment of all the premises that they supply water to determine the degree of hazard and to require the appropriate backflow prevention. It's very important that you have a record or evidence that this initial assessment was made and that you have a procedure in place for identifying new service connections. The default is that an on-site inspection is expected for an initial assessment. However, there are exemptions to this on-site inspection, which include residential areas that are without a known hazard. As long as a public water system has an alternate means to help identify these hazards, such as a review of residential building plans, actually doing distribution site visits, service areas for visuals, or flagging new businesses in residential areas. Or a public water system can use a questionnaire to document water use practices if it's not a high hazard facility, such as ones that are listed in 9504. Now for the periodic inspections, the periodic investigations or surveys, these have to be done on existing connections. And this has to be done every 5 years of all premises to identify if there's any new or increased hazards. It's important to have a written process or procedure and tracking mechanism along with records for these periodic resurveys. Again, the default is an on-site inspection is expected, but again, there's exemptions to the on-site inspection. That includes residential premises unlikely to have hazards. You can provide an education brochure or like an educational campaign to residential premises talking about the common residential backflow hazards. This education has to be direct delivered annually and provide a mechanism to report cross connections. Or alternately, a public water system can use an ongoing methodology. They would have a methodology that would capture changes in water use practices through triggered events, such as a request for a new service connection, a larger meter, collaboration with local permitting authorities, like if the local building department gets permits for additional plumbing or plumbing modifications, having the collaboration with the other agencies is important. Sending out those survey questionnaires, asking about water use practices and having the consumer return those. And again, on-site inspection if warranted, if there's a suspected new or increased hazard. In 9503, it's also the responsibility of the supplier of water to have the right to enter the premises to make these surveys investigations and to require that the consumer provide this information to them on water use practices. So moving on to 9504, again, there's some significant changes in 9504, essentially differentiating between requirements for what we would consider larger community public water systems, such as municipalities or villages, from those for non-community water systems or the smaller community water systems, such as apartment buildings or manufactured home parts. So we are providing more specific direction for each type of public water system so they can comply with backflow prevention provisions. And again, this was to clarify expectations. So 9504 addresses where protection is required. So an improved backflow preventer is required when a pollution system, health or severe health hazard to the public water system exists. For non-community and single property community water systems, the backflow preventer is required to be installed at the cross connection, so within the building plumbing. For all other community water systems, the backflow preventer is to be installed on the consumer service line serving the premises. Now, backflow preventers, as I mentioned earlier, for when an on-site inspection should be conducted, are for these high hazard facilities. These are facilities where you would expect a backflow preventer to be required. Hospitals, mortuaries, clinics, long-term care facilities, laboratories, docks and waterfront facilities, sewage treatment plants and pumping stations, car washes, food processing, or various industrial plants and bulk water loading. And 9504 also addresses requirements for auxiliary water systems. As I mentioned before, there should be no connection to an auxiliary water system. There has to be a physical separation. The only exemption to this is for fire protection purposes or if dual water supplies are necessary. And those requirements are outlined in rule. Now, if your community water system that, you know, provides through a metered service connection to a customer, again, the reduced pressure principle backflow preventer installed on the service line is also a requirement. Moving on to 9505, the type of protection required. Here we outline the different degrees of hazard and the minimum level of protection that's required. So for severe health hazard, this would be something, a contaminant that could cause severe morbidity or death, such as hazardous chemicals or sanitary sewage, an air gap is required. For a health hazard, something that would make somebody sick but not kill them, or a system hazard, something that would damage the infrastructure or the appurtenances of a piping system. The minimum requirement is a reduced pressure principle backflow prevention assembly. For a pollutional hazard, this is more for objectionable aesthetic reasons, like taste and odor issues, but wouldn't make somebody sick necessarily. A double check valve assembly is the minimum requirement. And there's an exception for residential irrigation systems that don't have pumps or additives. A public water system may choose to accept an approved pressure vacuum breaker on the irrigation system to mitigate the health hazard in lieu of requiring an RP at the service connection. The improvements we made to this rule are just replacing outdated language to improve readability. And 9505D, which speaks to the vacuum breaker, we put in the reference to the plumbing code requirements for vacuum breakers. So 9506, again, went through some additional modifications and improvements. We reverted to try to clarify the exact standards that are to be referenced when selecting a backflow preventer for a specific purpose. We added the air gap device, which are used on plumbing code applications. The standards are listed out in rule as before they reference the plumbing code. But we did this because the plumbing code changes and we didn't want the standards to get lost. So we cited them in our own rules, and they do remain complementary to the standards that are referenced in the plumbing code of the Ohio Building Code. We added installation criteria for backflow preventers. Now, this criteria is our current policies. It's not necessarily a new requirement. We just put it in there to provide additional clarity within the role as to expectations. And then in 9506 is where we added a condition which would allow the director to approve certain backflow preventers that are on building plumbing applications that are compliant with the plumbing code. And this is within single property community water systems and non-community water systems. We can accept a plumbing code compliant isolation backflow preventer in lieu of the containment backflow preventer that we cite in our rules for specific applications. Now, this table is a summary of basically 9505 and 06, where the hazard level is on, you know, the first column on the left, the minimum level of protection that's required, the standard that's referenced. So any acceptable backflow preventer has to meet at least one of these standards to be an approved containment backflow preventer. And then the level of protection that the backflow preventer provides. So above this solid line are the ones that are cited in rule. These are mostly universal applications because of they're not water use practice specific. They're more universally applied. And then below are the exceptions that we put into rule. Again, for residential irrigation, we can accept a pressure vacuum breaker. For single property community water systems and non-community water systems, where we're talking about a building public water system. For health system and pollutional hazards, we can accept what plumbing code requires. So if you're compliant with the plumbing code, you don't necessarily have to install one of these containment backflow preventers cited above. This would not apply when there's a severe health hazard because an air gap is necessary, or an auxiliary water system where a physical separation is necessary. So moving on to 9506, there were, again, like I mentioned, installation. I apologize, I'm continuing with 9506. The installation requirements, these are the ones that we put into rule. So backflow preventers can be installed either in a horizontal or a vertical position. Usually horizontal is what's approved, but often, well, sometimes there can be a vertical installation approved. So we just want that to match what has been approved per the standard. It must be readily accessible for inspection, testing, and repair. So don't put it somewhere where someone can't get to it and test it. We want them to be installed so they are not submerged. They're not meant to be submerged. They need to be protected from freezing. So if you're going to use a heated enclosure, use one that meets ASSE 1060, which is the standard for heated enclosures. And reduced pressure principle backflow preventers must not be installed within a pit or vault below ground. They have that relief valve that if it becomes submerged can just overcome the whole purpose of the RP. And so relief ports must have visible free discharge and floor drainage to handle that discharge. Now RPs, for example, will dump water if there's some pressure fluctuation. So you want to be able to have adequate drainage to handle that discharge. Testing requirements have always been in the rule. That needs to be done every 12 months. But we also specified that the annual inspections that certify there's no physical connection to auxiliary water systems is also included here. And then for building applications, isolation devices need to be inspected for wear and tear at least every 12 months. Records maintenance has always been part of this rule. Annual testing and inspections of backflow preventers should be maintained for at least 5 years. Any records of inventory of where the containment backflow preventers are installed and the initial assessments and the periodic surveys and investigations, those should be held as long as they're applicable, just to have a historical reference. Now, these records maintenance also include that auxiliary water system separation and regular inspection of backflow prevention devices. So for booster pumps, they must have a low pressure cutoff controller to maintain 10 PSI minimum suction pressure. This is important because if a minimum suction pressure is not maintained, booster pumps can actually create vacuum conditions on the suction side, which can lead to back siphonage. So the low suction throttling valve must be installed, or a low pressure cutoff, or a variable speed suction limiting control. Those are the three methods. There's just minor improvements in this rule, just to eliminate unnecessary text and update the reference. 9508 is essentially giving enforcement authority to the supplier of water to deny or discontinue water service when backflow prevention requirements aren't met. Again, this was just a minor improvement. It really didn't change the rule language. It just changed the title to more applicable title as to deny or discontinue water service. 9509 yard hydrants. The only change here was that new or replaced yard hydrants that are owned or part of a public water system that are intended for potable use must now meet the ASSE 1057 freeze-resistant sanitary yard hydrant standard. So existing yard hydrants, some of these have weep holes, which are common in Ohio because we have cold weather and the weep holes prevent the yard hydrant from freezing. However, the weep holes are a pathway for contamination to enter into the public water system. Therefore, if you're going to use that hydrant for potable purposes, those weep holes must be sealed with a manufacturer's plug to prevent that contamination. Now, if you don't have control over that yard hydrant, it's not part of your public water system, and it's on a private service connection, or you're not going to use it for potable use, a reduced pressure principle backflow preventer should be installed to mitigate that hazard. And that yard hydrant should be labeled not for human consumption or non-potable. This is just an illustration of, on the left would be your typical yard hydrant that's frost-proof, it's self-draining. Here you have the weep holes are located below ground. Again, if this is saturated, this soil around this yard hydrant, it can get siphoned into the supply, the water supply. So we don't want this, if these yard hydrants are going to be used for potable purposes, especially. And then on the right here is an example of a sanitary type yard hydrant. It has a reservoir that's located below grade, below the frost line. The water will drop into the reservoir. There's no open pathways underground for contamination to enter. It keeps it frost proof and sanitary. So essentially the water that's in this reservoir will discharge on the next use. So what are some common issues that our inspectors will typically find when they go out and inspect public water systems? Unprotected cross connections are a big deal. We often see discharge lines from processes, even water treatment plant processes, that are fed into sewer drains. There's no air gap there, and that's an unprotected cross connection. There's threaded hose connections where hoses have been left attached and submerged in containers, which create a cross connection and a pathway for contamination to enter into the public water system. Water pressure is sometimes used to eject in chemicals or fertilizers. This can be problematic if the connection is not protected with an anti-siphon device. We often see connections to auxiliary water systems, such as private wells, a cistern, a pond with a pump, connected to the building's water plumbing system. Again, auxiliary water systems, we don't know what the quality of the water is. It can introduce microbial contamination, chemical contamination, fertilizers, pesticides, whatever. We don't want that. We don't want that connection. Now, we also will see booster pumps that don't have a minimum suction pressure control on them. Again, could present a back siphonage hazard. So programmatically, these are the deficiencies that we'll typically see. A lack of records is a big one, especially for the initial inspection of service connections. We need to see something that that inspection was done, some proof that the initial inspection was done and that backflow prevention was applied if a hazard was present. Sometimes a backflow preventer is not appropriate for the degree of hazard. Sometimes we don't see that the backflow preventers are being regularly inspected or tested, or they've been bypassed or removed. Periodic inspections are not being done at times. Again, like I said, these periodic inspections need to be done at least every 5 years. Or the public water system doesn't have a written enforceable backflow prevention program, which is very important to have. So let's take a quick poll before I finish up my presentation. So if you could bring your attention to the poll question, I will read it. Are you a public water system operator, consultant, or work for a municipality or other? So please answer public water system operator, consultant, or work for a municipality or other.
Okay, I have launched the poll. So go ahead and make your selection. Looks like a lot of people have already voted. If you have not, please go ahead and make your final selection. So I'll close the poll here in a few seconds. Okay, I am sharing the results and back to you, Maria.
Okay, thank you. Oh, that's interesting. We have a lot of public water system operators, or that you work for a municipality, a few consultants and some others. So great. I like the diversity of the audience and I hope that you found my presentation helpful. So I'm going to close with my contact information. Please contact me if you have any questions or want to know where to find Ohio EPA's rules or guidance related to backflow prevention. I encourage you to check out Ohio EPA's Division of Drinking and Groundwater's website, where you can find out more information. Here is the link here. I also want to be sure to, again, remind you of the references that have been attached along with this presentation that will provide you with the URL links to some of the good information that we have on our website. There's also the backflow prevention manual, educational brochure that I mentioned as well that are attached. So thank you. You can move on to the questions and answers.
Okay, thank you, Maria. Now we're gonna go through some questions that were submitted during today's presentation. As a reminder, you can still submit questions through the questions pane. We'll do our best to answer as many as we can. If we don't answer your question during the Q&A portion, we'll reach out to you via email following today's session. So first question is, what's the difference between a backflow survey and a questionnaire?
Okay, that's a good question. So a survey is what you would think of like in a general sense. By definition, it's a general view, examination, or a description of something. A survey is about using the various means that a system has to gather information about backflow hazards that may be present at a particular service connection. So one of the means of gathering this information is using a questionnaire. So the survey can be accomplished by a combination of means, including the use of a questionnaire to gather the information for that particular facility or premises. So I hope that answered the question.
Okay. Another question is, should municipal public water systems be tracking the annual testing of isolation devices?
We are aware that some municipalities collectively enforce the testing of containment and isolation backflow preventers and track the annual testing of them, which is acceptable, but it's not a requirement under Ohio EPA. Ohio EPA's regulations apply to containment backflow preventers, while isolation devices are required and regulated by the Board of Building Standards Plumbing Code Enforcement Division. But as mentioned above, a comprehensive program which provides oversight of backflow prevention from the source to the tap is most protective. So it's not something that I would discourage, but it's not a requirement of Ohio EPA, however.
Okay, who is considered acceptable to test backflow preventers?
Okay, for containment backflow preventers, those that are required through Ohio EPA rules, it is an individual that is deemed qualified by the public water system or the director. Now, we provided guidance on who that qualified individual is. It should be somebody that has training in backflow prevention and cross-connection control concepts and understands and knows how to apply the backflow prevention test methods that are acceptable in Ohio. We strongly encourage the backflow tester to be somebody that is certified by the Ohio Department of Commerce's backflow tester certification process. If they are isolation devices, then Department of Commerce's certified tester requirements do apply.
Okay, here's another question. Does Ohio EPA have sample backflow ordinance language that a village could use?
Yes, we do. Actually, the backflow prevention manual, that's one of the attachments. We have some example ordinances in there that really that align with our rules. So there, it's something that you can use to develop your own set of rules for your public water system.
Okay. How should a system determine what type of backflow preventer device is required, just kind of in general?
I would refer you to the degrees of hazard that we define. The degrees of hazard are defined within the definition section in 9501, and then 9505 gives you the minimum level of protection that's required when a hazard's been identified. And then in 9504, again, I mentioned that list of facilities that you would typically require a backflow preventer for because they're higher hazard. That's a good reference point as well. So using those references, that would be my suggestion on how to determine what backflow preventer should be applied.
Okay, great. And we'll just take one more question and then wrap it up. So our last question is, are there any facility types that by their nature must have a backflow preventer?
Yes, as I mentioned above, the 9504 has a list of facilities that we would expect a backflow preventer to be applied. These are, again, higher hazard type facilities due to the water use practices and potential for cross connections and some serious backflow issues. These include hospitals, mortuaries, clinics, long-term care facilities, laboratories, chemical plants, metal plating industries, petroleum processing or storage, radioactive material processing plants, nuclear reactors, car washes, bulk water loading stations. And I also want to throw in there the temporary use of fire hydrants for bulk water sales. So this would be what I would suggest or what is required for facilities, for specific facilities in regard to backflow prevention.
Okay. Well, thank you, Maria, for your great presentation. Thank you, everyone, for attending this 2022 Virtual Compliance Assistance Conference session. Before we end the session today, we'd like to point your attention to another one of today's environmental fun facts. Ohio EPA recently awarded grants to nearly 100 schools, school districts, and dioceses in 70 communities to install or retrofit water fountains with water bottle filling stations in more than 200 school buildings. The grants help cover the cost of equipment and benefit the state by reducing the plastic bottle waste by encouraging students and school staff to carry reusable water bottles. Ohio EPA will offer the grants again in 2023, and the next grant cycle begins on November 7th with the application deadline on February 3rd of 2023. You can scan the QR code on the slide to learn more about it and register for the November 8th webinar. This slide provides information on how to register for these upcoming webinars, where to find recordings of previous webinars, and how to sign up to receive notifications of upcoming webinars through our Ohio EPA Customer Support Center. And as a reminder, we are recording all of the sessions for the entire Virtual Compliance Assistance Conference. We will post those on our YouTube channel. It will take us several weeks to get those up since there's 24 sessions. And with that, we will end this session of Ohio EPA's 2022 Virtual Compliance Assistance Conference. We hope you're able to join us for our last session later today. Thank you again for joining us and have a great day.